the sand. Tell me why the road turns. Ooh, I'm missing you. Tell me why the road turns. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to you, family. And you know, I would be remiss if I wouldn't do pay homage to my brother who made his transition on January 6th to be with the ancestors. And that was Bahamian born Academy Award actor, film director, and ambassador, Mr. Sidney Poitier. Mr. Sidney Poitier. Where do I begin? Where do I begin with a man who made me so proud as a kid? I guess I'm a kid of the 60s and 70s. So well, my elementary years was spent shaping years in the 60s. So, and 70s, I would say. So Sidney Poitier was a big part of that. Whether I watched the adults around me as a small child, being proud of him, you know, his entire, let me just start with this, okay? Because this brother has a lot of accolades and I want to take my time and do him justice, okay? First of all, he was born February 20th, 1927. He was born in Miami, Florida. A lot of people didn't know that. He died January 6th in Los Angeles, California. He's a Bahamian. I saw his house actually in the Bahamas. I went to visit his house in the Bahamas. He just brought so much. And so they say the year he's active was from 1946 to the year 2009. His first wife was Juanita Hardy. He married her in 1950, and he stayed married for 15 years. Second wife, Joanna Simkis, and he married her in 1976. However, from 1959 to 1968, he had a torrid affair, love affair, serious love affair with Diane Carroll. And a lot of people don't know why they never married. But it seemed like they both did the same thing to one another after their relationship with one another. I don't know. It's just kind of funny to me. They both had Caucasian mates after dating each other. So I don't know what that's all about. But with that being said, let's talk about him. His entire family lived in the Bahamas. Then it was still a crown colony. But he was born unexpectedly in Miami while his parents were visiting, which automatically granted him U.S. citizenship. He grew up in the Bahamas, though, and he moved to Miami at age 15 and to New York City at 16. He joined the Negro Theater, landing his breakthrough role as a high school student in the film Blackboard Jungle, 1955. Now, of course, I wasn't born yet. And I saw it in the 60s. And I was still a kid. I didn't understand it. So, 1958, he starred with Tony Curtis. Now, I remember this movie as well. Of course, I wasn't born yet. But playing him in the 60s gave us a good time to know who Sidney Poitier was. You didn't see that many black people on the screen, first and foremost. There was not too many people on the screen that looked like me. Okay? So, even as a kid, I noticed that. Okay? But I wasn't one of those kids that were just going to do this. Because that's what a lot of black kids did, because they couldn't identify themselves on television. A lot of y'all white people don't know that, do you? Yeah, a lot of black people at that time walking around talking to people like, be like, what the? Okay, that's neither here nor there. Let me finish. The defiant ones. He received a 9 Academy nominations for that role. I didn't know that. Both actors received the nominations for Best Actor, with Poitier being the first for a black actor, the nomination. They both had Best Actor nominations with Poitier winning. Yeah, with Poitier winning. Wow. In 1964, he won an Academy Award and the Golden Globe for Best Actor for, y'all know, Lilies of the Field. Long gone. Long gone. Some of those things I remember, movies I remember, I mean, I was a baby, but I remember my parents played this guy's movies all throughout. Well, we watched their movies because there wasn't no such thing as videos. And we went to the movies and they would take us to see him. Okay. For all y'all church people that didn't know, my mama was one that went to the movies. So we saw these things. And this was that Lilies of the Field. I think he was a handyman helping a group of German-speaking nuns build a chapel. Y'all know they really knew how to do it, didn't they? Poitier also received, that movie also starred somebody from my home, not my hometown, but from my home state. She's from Racine, which was right down the road. I think it was Barbara McNair. I think she was the lone black nun that was in that group. They brought her. Yeah. Well, what about Porgy and Bess, 1959? I wasn't born yet either. Raising His Son, 61. I was barely born now. But A Raisin in the Sun, of course, was the play, and it ended up being a movie. A Patch of Blue, where he went with the blind white girl. I remember that movie. He continued to break ground in 3 successful 1967 films in which issues that dealt with race and race relations. And just so y'all know, Sidney Poitier was a hell of an activist. Okay? And him and Harry Belafonte, Diane Carroll, they put a lot of money. Sammy Davis Jr. and almost them single-handedly kept the movement afloat, the civil rights movement, with their show, with their movement, their money. So it's important that you honor him for that as well. Wow. My man, The Heat of the Night. He received Golden Globe nominations for his performance in the last film and the poll next year at the U.S. box. He was voted U.S. top box office star. Beginning in the 1970s, Poitier also directed some comedy films. I know y'all remember Stir Crazy. What about Uptown Saturday Night? If y'all remember, he played a black version of To Sir With Love with all those black kids. And I think Shirley Ralph was one of the students. I think this was her first role. Shirley Ralph, y'all remember that? Come on, y'all got to help me out here because I remember it, but I can't think of it right now. That's when him and Bill Cosby worked a lot together. I'm interested in seeing what Bill Cosby would have to say about his death as well. And I never did hear what he said about them doing his friend like that. Anyway, they teamed up and they made a bunch of movies together with Boonzy Farmsworth, which was J.J. Walker, whatever his real name is, Jimmy Walker. Okay. So he did a lot of movies throughout the decades that we love. As young kids coming up, preteens. Anyway, Poitier was granted a knighthood by Queen Elizabeth II in 1974. In 1995, he received the Kennedy Center Honor. And from 1997 to 2007, he was Bahamian Ambassador to Japan. In 2009, he was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the highest civilian honor in the United States. And he was bestowed that honor by Barack Obama. Yes, he was. In 2016, he was awarded the BAFTA Fellowship for Outstanding Lifetime Achievement in Film. And in 1999, he ranked 22nd among male actors on the 100 Years, 100 Stars list by American Film Institute. In 1982, he received a Golden Globe Cecil B. DeMille Award. And in 2000, he received the Screen Actors Guild Lifetime Achievement Award. In 2002, he was given an honorary Academy Award and recognition in his remarkable accomplishments as an artist, as a human being, as an activist. I mean, somebody that really cared about the people. Sidney was the youngest of seven children. He was born to Evelyn and Reginald Poitier, Bahamian farmers who owned a farm on Cat Island. The family would travel to Miami to sell tomatoes and other produce. His father also worked as a cab driver in Nassau. Poitier was born unexpectedly in Miami while his parents were visiting. His birth was 3 months premature, and he was not expected to live. So his parents remained in Miami for 3 more months to nurse him back to health. But he grew up in the Bahamas, then a British town colony. Owing to his unplanned birth in the United States, he was automatically entitled to a U.S. citizenship. Okay. Some believe, though, that Poitier's ancestors had migrated from Haiti and were probably among the runaway slaves who established maroon communities throughout the Bahamas, including Cat Island. He noted that Poitier is a French name and that there were no white Poitiers in the Bahamas. However, there had been a white Poitier on Cat Island. The name came from the planter Charles Leonard Poitier, who had immigrated from Jamaica in the early 1800s. In 1834, his wife's estate on Cat Island had 86 black slaves who kept the name Poitier, a name that had been introduced into the Anglosphere since the Norman conquest of the 11th century. So Poitier lived with his family on Cat Island until he was 10, and then they moved to Nassau. When he got exposed to the modern world, and he was like, damn. So he saw automobiles. He first experienced electricity, indoor plumbing, refrigeration, and Lord, the motion pictures. He was raised a Catholic, but later became agnostic with views closer to deism. Okay. At 15, though, he was sent to Miami to live with his brother's large family. At 16, he moved to New York City looking to become an actor, holding a string of jobs as a dishwasher and other small jobs in the meantime. After failing his first audition with the Negro American Theater due to his inability to read the script, an elderly Jewish waiter sat with him every night for several weeks, helping him to learn and to read using the newspaper. My mama always tell me something, and I always think about it in my times of despair. She says, Mama, I just love you so much, because the older I get, those truisms that you told me come to play. She said, God always got a ram in the bush. Always. Always got a ram in the bush. So during World War II in 1943, he lied about his age and enlisted in the Army. He was assigned to a Veterans Administration hospital in Northport, New York, and was trained to work with psychiatric patients. But Poitier became so upset at how the hospital treated his patients so that he feigned mental illness to obtain a discharge. Poitier confessed to a psychiatrist that he was faking his condition, but the doctor was sympathetic and granted his discharge under the Section 8 of Army Regulation 615-360 in December 1944. After leaving the Army, he worked as a dishwasher until a successful audition landed him a role in an American Negro theater production, the same company that he failed his first audition with. Ain't that something? Now, some of his early work, he joined, Poitier joined a Negro theater, but he was rejected by the audiences. Contrary to what was expected of black actors at the time, Poitier's tone deafness made him unable to sing. He was determined to refine his acting skills and rid himself of his noticeable Bahamian accent. He spent the next 6 months dedicating himself to achieving theatrical success. He modeled his legendary speech pattern after radio personality Norman Brokenshire. On his second attempt at the theater, he was noticed and given a leading role in the Broadway production of Lysistra, which, though it ran a failing 4 days, he received an invitation to understudy for Anna Lacosta. So, which is good, you know, that propelled him to at least have an invitation to be an understudy for another production that was going on. But in 1947, he was a founding member of the Committee for the Negro in Arts, an organization whose participants were committed to a left-wing analysis of class and racial exploitation. And see, there you go with his activism. By 1949, Poitier had chose between leading roles on stage and an offer to work in Daryl F. Zanuck's film No Way Out, 1950. His performance in No Way Out as a doctor treating a Caucasian bigot, played by Richard Widmark, who became a friend, was noticed and led to many more roles, each considerably more interesting and more prominent than one before. And the most African-American actors of the time were offered. So he was more like the Denzel. Denzel was more like him of his day. You know, the certain kind of role that he took and projected. And he was behind the scenes steady, I call it. In 1951, anyway, he traveled to South Africa with the African-American actor Canada Lee to star in the film version of Cry, the Beloved Country. Oh, my God, Canada Lee. Anyway, Poitier's distinction continued in his role as Gregory W. Miller, a member of the incorrigible high school class in the Blackboard Jungle. It was his performance in Martin Ritt's Edge of the City that the industry could not ignore him any longer. It was a pitch tour stardom granted for him. He enjoyed working with William Wellman on Goodbye, My Lady in 1956. Wellman was a big name, and he had previously directed the famous movie, I guess, Roxy Hart with Ginger Rogers and Magic Town with James Stewart. So he began to get bigger and bigger roles, what it looks like. It's funny because as he began to grow, this guy Wellman said that he had a sensitivity that about him. And that's the same thing that Poitier felt about him. He said he has a sensitivity about him, which Wellman felt he needed to hide. But Poitier later praised him for inspiring his thoughtful approach to directing when he found himself taking the helm on the Buck and the Preacher. Y'all remember that one with Harry Belafonte? Wow. Because that started the little movies, like the little blaxploitation with Buck and the Preacher and the rest of them that he did with, what's his name? Bill Cosby. So, you know, he had a very illustrious career. And one of the famous roles that he did for black people is when he played alongside Ruby Dee in The Raisin in the Sun. He did that on the Broadway stage at the Ethel Barrymore Theater in 1959. And then the play was directed by Lloyd Richards. The play introduced details of black life to the overwhelmingly white Broadway audiences. So, while director Richards observed that it was the first play to which large numbers of black people were drawn, it was a groundbreaking play, a piece of American theater which Frank Rich, critic from New York Times, was writing that A Raisin in the Sun had changed American theater forever. Black people are American theater. Black people are American culture. Whenever y'all get through, we are the culture. Everything we do, you done copied off of us. Everything we done put into place, you make it now like it's yours. From day one. And I know this conversation has gotten off from my brother, but it's all intertwined. To let you know how enmeshed we are. How to let you know how enmeshed we are as black and white people in America. Hell, when you can look at your great-grandfather and know he was a white man, then what? What is all this craziness? That's how I know that you're dealing with some of y'all is just absolutely insane. Okay? Because how could you be crazy with us like that? And here we are all living in mesh. The slaves, the slave master, the sons and daughters of the slaves, the great-great-granddaughters and great-great-grandsons of the slave masters. What the? Come on, man. Yeah. Y'all world was rocked when they saw A Raisin in the Sun. And it was just us being Negroes. Being who we were. So then in 1961, he started in the film adaptation for A Raisin in the Sun, for which he received another Golden Globe nomination. Also in 1961, Poitier starred in Paris Blues alongside Paul Newman and Joanne Woodard, Louis Armstrong, and Diane Carroll. Y'all already know what happened after that with Diane Carroll. Because that just went on for, you know, ever and ever and ever and ever. You know, he was married to Juanita Hardy from April 29, 1950, I told y'all, and until 1965. I believe that's Sherry's and Gina's mama. And but that 9-year affair that he had with the actress Diane Carroll, that was something else. And it was a talk of it. I remember my parents talking about it for sure. I didn't know that it started in 1959. Wow. So at the end of that, he married Joanna Shimkus, a Canadian actress who starred with Poitier in The Lost Man. They remarried. They remained married for the rest of his natural life. He had 4 daughters with his first wife, Beverly, Pamela, Sherry, and Gina. 2 with his second wife, Anika and Sidney. In addition to his 6 daughters, Poitier had 8 grandchildren and 3 great-grandchildren. When Hurricane Dorian hit the Bahamas in September 2019, the Poitier family had 23 missing relatives. Wow. Interesting. I don't know if any have been found or what the update on that is, but, you know, he is an American treasure. He is a Bahamian treasure. He is a beacon of light. He was an activist. He was somebody that we could truly, truly, truly be proud of as black people. Because he didn't come with all that yin yang. He came, he was dignified. And he made you aspire up, not want to be down. He played roles that showed us in significant character, showed us in significant light, that made us proud to be black people. not gangsters. I mean, that's got its place. But he wanted to show that we're just as monolithic as anyone. And it's amazing how fast time goes. Because I remember the movie he played in with another guy from Wisconsin. And he ended up eating a rat in that movie. That was probably one of the last movies that he made. If y'all could think of it, put it, make a down in the comment about it. It was him and the Tom Berenger, I think his name is. Yeah. But he sure showed that we had diversity. And even though there weren't a lot of representation of black people, I think Sidney Poitier wore it well. He wore it proudly, and he made us proud of him. Thank you, Sidney. Thank you for a legacy. Thank you for your wonderful life, and thank you for your activism and everything you did that I enjoy, the freedoms that I enjoy today, for the work that you put in. Rest now, brother. Well done, my good and faithful servant. That's what I can hear God say. All right, you guys, I'll see you in the next video. And I know that was fairly long, but I think he deserved that. He deserved just that. And I'll see you in the next video.